How about let's go ahead and be standing if you would. Well, that would really turn for a long time. Stand for a long time. I will ask this legitimate question. Do you want to be close to God? Would you like to become closer to God? I think that's a fair desire regarding most people, especially in our room. And I thought, well, what happens if you just type that into your sermon, your search engine? I want to be closer to God. You get a whole list of results. And I had to click on the WikiHow result because it said, how to get closer to God with pictures. What could be easier than a list of pictures? And they even have two options. They have two tracks that you can take. If you would like to get closer to God through option A, which is prayer, or through other ways. And then the first item under other ways was talk to God, which is prayer. So, but and don't get me wrong, they had very helpful, a lot of good content in there. In the prayer tracks, and speak to God as if you're talking to a friend. No need to be fancy. Trust that God has His own timelines and reasons. Under the other ways to get close to God, they read your Bible. They had pay attention and participate in church, which I really like that one. Don't make promises to God that you can't keep. And there's nothing wrong with the vast majority of what I read on that site. You just have to be careful because you know how they stick those ads in right in the middle of the list. You know, want to be ordained today? Click here. Then there's only like six ways to talk to God right next to eight ways to flatten your stomach. So it's kind of woven in there. And that was one of 77,600,000 results. A lot of information. Because it's a very valid question. For the vast majority of people, I would say, at least deep down, if they're honest, they would like to be closer to God. And some people will put out those videos, you know, and they'll say, I love God. I want to get closer to Jesus. It's a church I apply. That I can do without. Or the vast majority of the same-sex argument. I don't hear any of these people saying, we want this lifestyle, and we don't care if God's not a part of it at all. We don't need God. We don't care about God. We don't want Him involved. That's not what they say, is it? We want this lifestyle, and God wants it too. And God is already here in our camp, and He is on board. And those who have read chapter 5 in the story, you know that's just not always the case. People who are familiar with the Scriptures, especially the Old Testament, you know that can't always be true. There are a number of times in the Scripture that illustrates God said, I have to turn away, remove myself, I can't be in this situation. And this is the point of this chapter this morning, this idea of new commands and a new covenant. And we have been saying since chapter 1 that God wants to be with His people. You know, he created that beautiful Garden of Eden and that experience in the first chapter. And Adam and Eve sever that relationship with their sin and God has to expel them. But He has been constantly working to renew the relationship. And for some time now in history, He's been working somewhat at a distance. Now He's ready to come together. We will renew this walk. New garden, if you will. We have a land flowing with milk and honey. Fresh start. God wants to be close, have an intimate relationship with His people. But for that to happen, God has these conditions that have to be met. You see the three of them that we list in the outline. And God still wants that today. He wants the same intimate relationship with us. And it doesn't matter your past. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life. God wants to be with us. God wants to be in our midst. And for that to occur today, the same conditions have to be met. His first condition, God insisted that people live by a set of guidelines so they would treat each other better than people had been treating each other in the past. And now those guidelines are known better today to us as what? The Ten Commandments. The ten things you cannot put on the wall of a school or in front of a courthouse. They're found in your text, in the story, pages 61 and 62. In our Old Testament scriptures, they are located and listed in Exodus, second book of the Bible, Exodus chapter 20. For all the instructions, for all the teachings in the Bible, you notice that the Ten Commandments, take up less than a page. In my Bible, it's about half a page. And I kind of made that offhand remark about the schools and the courthouses, because those have become a bone of contention. And now, this is where we argue. It's a battleground for some people posting the Ten Commandments. I don't quite understand this logic. Every time I see them trying to remove it, especially from a courthouse, I say, what is your beef? This doesn't make sense to me. Why is it that it's wrong to post, thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not steal, on the lawn of the very building where you're going to try people for those same crimes? God's not allowed to say it out in the yard, but the judge is going to tell you the very same thing inside. That's okay. Maybe if you let people read it for themselves out in the grass, you wouldn't have to handcuff them and drag them in here and tell them after the fact. And I don't know why it is some people with rules, and Randy Frazee wrote it this way, it's our human nature to stand up on the inside and defy authority. No one's going to tell me what to do. As though we like rules when they enforce somebody else's behavior toward us. If my little kids are out playing in the yard and some car goes screaming down the street, I want Mr. Policeman to come and give them a ticket, sure. But if I just happen to be going a little over the speed limit, well, you know, I'm in complete control of my vehicle. I can stop on a dime. No need to give any ticket here, Mr. Officer. And would you agree that most people fuss about rules that they don't really understand? Or maybe they don't remember the reason for the rules. And Stephen alluded as well to the rules of the road. I'm mindful of this now. I have the new truck. My full-size pickup is a lot bigger than the little Nissan I used to have. And I'm more mindful of side and distance. And I'm coming down the road, two-lane road, one day this week, and I see the warning vehicle that comes with the big orange oversized load is following us. And I was very appreciative of that, because this particular oversized load was a very thin steel box. And it was black. It's about as wide as these pews, seemed like to me. And it's coming down, and if I'm not paying attention, or that warning's not there, it was about head high in my truck. Now, if I don't get over here, it's going to hit me right in the face. And it was the same road a couple days later, and I'm behind the truck is pulling the bean header, which you know how massive those are, even long ways, from the combine, and the forks are sticking out this way, and there's a mail truck in front of all of us, and the bean header has to go around the mail, and there's all kinds of signs and warnings in order to keep things. Those all have reasons. Maybe we've already forgotten how much traffic there used to be right here in front of the church. When this was a two-lane road, you could be going 50, 60 miles an hour, and a semi's coming the other way at that speed or more, and you might maybe be 6-8 feet apart. Both drivers better well know and abide by the rules of the road. It was written this way: following the rules of the road is not meant to ruin your trip. It's not meant to take away the joy of the open road. They're designed to say you stay alive. And people who don't appreciate the Ten Commandments, they don't understand the reasoning. And if your class watches Randy Frazee's video, or it might be in his book, this morning. So some people just see God as some distant judge. He's just sentencing lawbreakers. Or he's the mean old school principal that just waits for some kid to act up and call him in the office and let him have it. Hurling rules and regulations at people, watching him, catching him, so he can eventually punish him and enjoy that whole process. He described him as a sadistic, cosmic killjoy. That's what some people think. That's not the point of the laws at all. God provides these rules because he knows, left to our own devices, we can't get along. Is that not exactly what is happening as society, in many ways, fractures around us? If we can't agree to abide by God's one set of rules handed down from a perfect lawgiver, there's no way we're going to agree to multiple sets created by multiple players for various reasons. That's not going to happen. It's hard enough to keep God's rules. And we usually know, when we talk about the Ten Commandments, we usually note that commandments 1 to 4 are the vertical axis of the cross, the me and God commands. No other gods before me. No. Pretty straightforward. Just God. No other gods. Worship me. No others. And then you read in the text and you realize that the people of Israel, they couldn't make it 40 days. They couldn't make it 40 days before their melting down earrings, and out comes this golden calf, and they're breaking the first and the second commandments. About a month. And later in the text, Jesus is going to summarize these 10 commands and essentially, for lack of a better term, boil it down to two. This is Matthew 22, 37 to 40. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind." Commands 1 to 4. This is the first and greatest command. And the second is like it. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. It's almost as if Jesus said, if 10's too overwhelming, I'll give you two. Try to abide by these two things. Love God, love other people, don't hurt others, don't take advantage of others, obey these commandments, and we will all get along. And it seems so simple. And it's so challenging. And why is that? Because of these other people. These other people who sin nature butts head with my sinful self. Tonight, Paul, Romans 7, same concern. Why do I do what I know is wrong? One guy said, he was talking to his buddy, he said, "Hey, I heard you and your wife had a big argument last night." "Yeah, we did." "Well, how'd it come out?" "Well, she came to me crawling on her hands and knees." "Really? What'd she say?" "She said, get out from under that bed and fight like a man." In the lower story, people think the rules are just that God just wants to catch us and punish us. But the upper story, God says, these are boundaries. This facilitates harmony. It enables us to be the kind of society that God can be around. And when you understand God's society and His kingdom and His economy, then no, I don't have to spend a lot of time trying to steal or covet, hoarding stuff up. I don't need to do that because I trust that God will provide. So I challenge you to take a fresh look at the Ten Commandments this week in Exodus 20. Read this list this week. Try to see them as a do. I know it's like, don't do that. What does it tell me to do? Don't steal. Well, share. Make sure that other people have what they need so no one needs to steal. Second condition that God listed was this. If I'm going to come down and live in your midst, I'm going to need a place to stay. And I don't know if you've ever waded through in your Bible reading through like Exodus 25, 26, 27, 28, 30. Tons of instructions. Here's all these blueprints and guidelines and materials and facilities and garments. And then that's almost repeated nearly verbatim in chapter 35, 36, 37, 38, through 40 as they build all the stuff. Why all these detailed instructions in Scripture? Because it's for God. Is God not worthy of a nice place to stay? When we have loved ones come home from the hospital or from rehab or surgery, they need, quote, a place to stay and the equipment to facilitate that. And we do that, right? Walkers, wheelchairs, risers in the bathroom, the hose, the stockings, and we put that on and we take that off. We facilitate everything we can as instructed if we want the best result. John Stover has a medical needs closet in Johnstown. That room is nearly as big as this one, seems like to me. And it's just filled with equipment to provide the right place. When you bring a baby home from the hospital, they need, quote unquote, a nice place to stay. And the equipment to do that. And we facilitate that. And we, you know, this is my list off the top of my head. Cribs, bassinets, car seats, changing tables, strollers, walkers, high chairs, bouncy things. Floor mats, blankets, playpens, ball pits, on and on and on and on that list goes. And we baby-proof the cupboards and then the kitchen and then the whole house. And you think about this. These little bundles of joy put all kinds of demands on the family. But we do it all willingly and lovingly. Because they're worth every bit of it. Is it unreasonable for God to ask for a nice place to stay? When you go on a trip, the more you spend, the nicer you expect it to be. And God asked Moses, he asked the Israelites to make this nice, this tabernacle. The word tabernacle means tent, place of dwelling. You can see a diagram of it there. This is the God would meet with his people, and he's certainly worth it. Adam Barr was writing about this thread. He said, one of the threads in the story is that God wants to live with his people. And that was his desire with the Garden of Eden. And now it's represented as the tabernacle, and then later it will be the temple. And we know in the New Testament, he's going to say, I don't need brick and mortar, but in the lives and the hearts of church people. And then we're waiting for that day when he comes back and renews new heaven and new earth, new relationship. In every one of those eras, God is unchanging and worthy of worship. And I think Craig Travis was quoting in his meditation, he mentioned Bob Russell talking about when they spend millions of dollars on a church building. What did he say? This facility is our vehicle through which we reach out to people in the world. Is there any expense that's too much for that endeavor? And we're focusing on the tabernacle this morning because that's the essence of the chapter 5 situation. What is the place of meeting today for God? 2015, and we would say, well, see, this is our facility, 5380 Moots Run Road. This is our address. And then we say, where does God reside today? And we would say correctly, within us, in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives. His spirit does not solely dwell within these walls. You know that when you leave this place, God goes. He doesn't just hang out here in this room. There's no Holy of Holies back there behind that screen. You know, in fact, if you want to look back there, you want to see what's really back there? Yeah, it's a big mess. That's what's back there. Bunch of junk. We try to keep what you see clean and nice. We try to keep that closed. You want it to be excellent. You want people to be able to invite it to the place. But if I want to give God the best possible place to reside, I got to clean up my heart and my mind. I got to pull the weeds in my life and my habits. This is 1 Corinthians 3:16. Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? Well, 1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20 that we've had. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. God lives in me. He wants a personal, intimate, close relationship with me. How can I make this dwelling place as excellent as possible? Did the way you used your body last week honor God? All the efforts that we put into diet and exercise and walking and working out and staying away from sugars and sodas, and it's for physical health and it's for energy and well and good, but it's a spiritual blessing too. I want to make the temple as fit as I can for God's holy presence. I want him to have a nice place to stay. Please make every effort this week to encourage and challenge your spouse, your kids, as far as emotional and mental health. Those are equally valid contributors. Ask them. Watch for signs. Get the help if it's needed. Or maybe putting something off. Gentlemen, this is usually us. Are you putting something off physically that could hinder your service for God? I just think guys are the worst at this. And we put off repairs to this vehicle that we would never do to the car or the truck or the house. You know, how many of those guys say, well, you know, the truck's got 3 tires, pretty decent. You know, just kind of lean on the fender when you drive and keep that bad one off the road. You don't do that. I know the house has a leak in the roof, but it really only rained hard 2 days, so we're okay. We don't do that with that stuff. But with this, it's all right. What do I need to do to make God's dwelling place the best it can possibly be? He deserves it. And the third requirement that he had for community was a way to restore fellowship between a holy God and a sinful people. We've talked about this a lot. We've looked at what sacrifice for sins does for us from our side. What does it do for God? What does a sacrifice do for God? Randy Frazee said he, talking about God, he desperately wanted to reconnect with the people he had created, but their sin stood in the way. You see, God and sin cannot peacefully coexist. I love that phrase. Have you ever used that phrase? We cannot peacefully coexist. I think we all probably are more aware than one another. Bearcats and students one day, and one of them said, I can't be in the same room with the spawn of Satan. That's what they were calling each other in high school. We cannot coexist. Now the difference here is us as human beings, especially if you have two human beings who are infused with the Holy Spirit, we ought to be able to exist. Coexist. We ought to be able to come together and meet in the middle and give and take. This is God and sin. This is different because their nature is never going to change. God doesn't need to change. He doesn't have to change. He's not going to accommodate sin. So you either have to cover it or correct it, get rid of it. Hence the third book in your Old Testament, Leviticus. And it might be too late this year. If you read through the Bible a year, you're probably already past Leviticus. But it will come up again next year. Remember this conversation. I looked at my list. For me, it'll be the end of February, the 1st of March. I need to remember this statement. Many consider the book of Leviticus to be one of the most boring books in the Bible. From a lower story perspective, it's not exactly a page turner. But it is one of the most important books in the Bible because it lays out what has to happen before sinful mankind can be reconciled to God. One of the most important books of the Bible. Have you read Leviticus lately? Have you read Leviticus 13? It's a long chapter that talks about infectious skin diseases and regulations about mildew. And somebody here, if you're honest with me, I never make it that far. Be honest. You know, like, I never get past chapter 5 or 6. You know, I read through Leviticus and they have all of those, the burnt offerings and the guilt offerings and the sin offerings and the offerings and offerings. It's one of the most important books in the Bible because it lays out what has to happen before a sinful mankind can be reconciled to a holy God. This is God saying, if you want to be closer to me, I want to be closer to you. This is what needs to happen. And thankfully, there's a new song, that was then, this is now. Thankfully, we don't have to do this. And I'm not saying you shouldn't treat skin infections or clean up mold or mildew. That's fine. You know, we still do those things for other reasons. For Moses, for the Israelites, God demanded the sacrifice of lambs and calves because in their economy and their culture, they were very valuable. Spilling their blood meant something. You know, Derek just had in his meditation last week, I'm glad we don't have to do that. I'm glad we don't have to go in that room and bring out a lamb and sacrifice it. And I wonder how many of us are like, yeah, because we're not lamb people. You know, that doesn't impact me. I don't really have much thought about lambs. But they did. In that day, they did. If you are asked to spill the blood of the best of the future of your flock, that means something. That costs. And we have the perfect sacrifice, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Here's His blood on the cross for a new covenant. That matters even more. This is the end of the sermon, what I want to say. In this regard, it should be pretty easy. Shouldn't it? We should be able to come to the front of the church and say, I accept that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and I want to make every effort to repent of my sins, and I will meet you back here and be immersed into Christ, and it's really not that hard. But it is. Because it's going to demand the best of everything you have. It's going to be in every compartment. Every day. Time, money, ability, relationships. All sacrifice. Is it worth it? Oh, it's worth it. He is worth it. God is worth any effort that I would make to come closer to Him. He wants to be close to the people that He loves. The people that are in this room and the people that are lost out there. God wants us to love the lost people like He does. He wants us to go out there this week and He wants us to say, this is how you can be closer to God. This is how God can be a more intimate part of your life. Abide by His guidelines. Make a nice place for Him to stay. Accept the blood of the Lamb as the cost of reconciliation. That's the message we need to share. And if you're one of those people who likes an action step or a particular application, how about this? Will you be Moses for America this week? Will you stand in the gap between a holy God and an increasingly unholy nation? Because that's the whole golden calf incident. If you read the chapter, and the people don't make it very long, and they are breaking the commands, and when Moses comes back to camp, he's furious, and he breaks the commandments, and God is even more livid. And Moses stands in the gap to essentially protect these people. And I'll finish from Exodus 32, beginning with verse 9. This is the conversation and the effort that Moses made on behalf of some undeserving people. Exodus 32, 9. I have seen these people, the Lord said to Moses, and they're a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I'll make you into a great nation. But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. O Lord, he said, why should your anger burn against your people, whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, it was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and be their inheritance forever. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. Will we be Moses for America this week? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are mindful of your holiness, of all that is required of us and instructed to us in order to come as close to you as possible. And we know that your desire is to be active and complete in our lives in every facet of every day. And we know that there are those who choose to make this relationship more difficult for themselves and for others through their efforts and their choices. Father, we know that sometimes it's very easy to just want to wipe our hands and walk away and come apart and stay to the side and not have any involvement. But Father, we know that we need to plead the case of your people, to plead the case of your mercy and your grace and your love. We pray that you will enable us to do that this week. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And we do always invite you. Every week at this point, we will encourage you and challenge you. Say, I'm willing to stand and be counted amongst those. And if you have that decision to make this morning, let's stand together. We'll sing this invitation without any flattery.
Encourage you to stay for class with us this morning. You come back tonight, we'll have
worship the youth groups at 7 o'clock, and we're celebrating everybody's birthday at 8. You're welcome to stay and have a once-a-year birthday party with us. There are several events coming up. I know the high school men and women have an event on the 17th. Guys at the cabin, I think at 9, and the girls are Pinterest party here at 10 on Saturday the 17th. We'll have the hayride on Saturday the 24th. Start at 2 o'clock, go out through the afternoon, ride in the evening, and the meal. We will, in a couple weeks probably, when it comes time to sing, sometimes it's hard to see with all the lights. Some people, it's just more comforting or engaging to be not quite so bright. So if you see some of the lights turned off and it's too dark for you to see the words, there you go. Okay, so there's about 6 or 8 of these back there in the box. And I appreciate the hymns and the harmony, and if you need to see to read that, you say it got too dark in here, you're welcome to those. But just, we won't do that during sermon. We'll leave the lights on so you can see and such. But just be mindful of trying to encourage people who want to be able to worship and share together. I don't know, Stephen, is there anything else for young people that I miss?
Well, immediately after Sunday school, I think the girls have an event planned, but it's for everybody, all the youth group.
Okay.
To Skyline into a movie.
Okay.
They'll be kind of rising from here right after church.
After church today. Can you pray for us, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. God, as our world becomes more evidently darker sometimes, God, gap between the two worlds seems clear, I guess, God, and I pray that you help us, God, to go out and to bridge that gap, God, that you give us the strength and the perseverance to do that, God, and that you intervene where needed. God, pray that we be your light in this world, and that you guide and direct us as we go from here. You sing and pray. Amen.
Let's close this morning by singing, O Lord.